How good is an AI model at forecasting? We can put an actual number on it. In machine learning, a loss function tracks the degree of error in the output from an AI model. And it does this by quantifying the difference, or the loss, between a predicted value. So let's say that that is 5, the model gave us 5 as the output, and then comparing that to the actual value. So maybe the model gave us 10, and we call that the ground truth. Now, if the model's predictions are accurate, then the difference between these two numbers, the loss in effect, is comparatively small. If its predictions are inaccurate, let's say it came back with an output of 1 instead of 5, then the loss is larger. So let me give you an example of how we can use this. Now, I have a colleague who built an AI model to forecast how many views his videos would receive on YouTube. He fed the model YouTube titles, and then the model forecast how many views that video would receive in its first week. Here they are. A little bit vain if you ask me, but it wasn't me, it was my colleague. Now, how well did the model do? Well, when comparing the model forecasts to the actual number of real YouTube views, the model wasn't getting too close. The model predicted that the cold brew video would bomb and the pour over guide video would be a big hit. Just wasn't the case though. Now, this is a hard problem to solve, and clearly this model needs some adjustments, and that's where loss functions can help. Loss functions let us define how well a model is doing mathematically. And if we can calculate loss, we can then adjust model parameters and see if that increases loss, meaning it's made it worse, or if it decreases loss, meaning it's made it better. And at some point, we can say that a machine learning model has been sufficiently trained when loss has been minimized below some predefined threshold. Now, at a high level, we can divide loss functions into two types: regression loss functions and then classification loss functions. And let's start with regression, which measures errors in predictions involving continuous values. Predictions like the price of a house, or the temperature for a given day, or, well, the views for a YouTube video. Now, in these cases, the loss function measures how far off the model's predictions are from the actual continuous target values. Now, regression loss must be sensitive to two things, basically: whether the forecast is correct or not, but also the degree to which it diverges from the ground truth. And there are multiple ways to calculate regression loss functions. Now, the most common of those is called MSE, or mean squared error. Now, as its name suggests, MSE is calculated as the average of the squared difference between the predicted value and the true value across all training examples. And squaring the error means that MSE gives large mistakes a disproportionately heavy impact on overall loss, which strongly punishes outliers. So that's MSE. MAE, or mean absolute error, measures the average absolute difference between the predicted value and the actual value. MAE is less sensitive to outliers compared to MSE, as it doesn't square the errors. So how do you decide which regression loss function to pick? Well, if your ground truth data has relatively few extreme outliers with minimal deviation, like, I don't know, the temperature ranges in the month of July in the southern US, which, trust me, is basically always hot, well, then MSE is a particularly useful option for you, as you want to heavily penalize predictions that are far off from the actual values. MAE is a better option when data does contain more outliers, and we don't want those outliers to overly influence the model. Forecasting demand for a product, that's a good example where occasional surges in sales shouldn't overly skew the model. But there is a third choice. That third choice is called Huber loss. Now, Huber loss is a compromise. It's a compromise between MSE and MAE. It behaves like MSE for small errors and like MAE for large errors, which makes it useful when you want the benefits of penalizing large errors, but not too harshly. Now, I've calculated the loss functions for the YouTube example, This is the MAE value, summing up the absolute differences, meaning on average, the predictions were off by about 16,000 views per video. The MSE loss function, that's over 400 million. It skyrockets, and that's due to the squaring of large errors. And the Huber loss, that also indicates poor predictions, but provides a more balanced perspective, penalizing large errors less severely than MSE. But look, these numbers don't mean a whole lot on their own. We'll want to adjust the model's parameters, generate new forecasts, and see where we move the needle on loss. But before we get to how to do that, let's talk about the other type of loss function, classification. Unlike regression loss functions, which deal with predicting continuous numerical values, classification loss functions, well, they're focused on determining the accuracy of categorical predictions. Is an email spam or not spam? Are these plants classified into their correct species based on their features? So the loss function in classification tasks measures how well the predicted probabilities or labels match the actual categories. Now, cross entropy loss is one way of doing this. And it's the most widely used loss function for classification tasks. Now, what's entropy? It's a measure of uncertainty within a system. So if you're flipping a coin, there are only two possible outcomes, heads or tails. The uncertainty is pretty low, so low entropy. Rolling a six-sided die means there's more uncertainty about which of these six possible numbers will come up. The entropy is higher. Now, cross-entropy loss measures how uncertain the model's predictions are compared to the actual outcomes. In supervised learning, model predictions are compared to the ground truth classifications provided by data tables. Those ground truth labels are certain, and so they have low, or in fact, no entropy. As such, we can measure the loss in terms of the difference in certainty we'd have using the ground truth labels to the certainty of the labels predicted by the model. Now, an alternative to this is called hinge loss instead. Now, this is commonly used in support vector machines, and hinge loss encourages the model to make both correct predictions and to do so with a certain level of confidence. It's all about measuring that level of confidence. And it focuses on maximizing the margin between classes, with the goal that the model is not just correct, but it's confidently correct by a specified margin. And this makes hinge loss particularly useful in binary classification tasks, where the distinction between classes needs to be as clear and as far apart as possible. So we've calculated our loss function, great, but what can we do with that information? Now remember that the primary reason for calculating the loss function is to guide the model's learning process. The loss function provides a numeric value that indicates how far off the model's predictions are from the actual results. And by analyzing this loss, we can adjust the model's parameters, typically through a process called optimization. In essence, the loss function acts as a feedback mechanism, telling the model how well it's performing and where it needs to improve. The lower the loss, the better the model's predictions align with the true outcomes. Now, after adjusting the YouTube prediction model, we get a new set of forecasts, and we can now compare the loss functions between the two models. And in all three cases, the loss function is now lower, indicating less loss with the greatest effect on MSE, mean squared error, as the model reduced the large prediction error for the pour over video. Now that's loss function as an evaluation metric, but it can also be used as input into an algorithm that actually influences the model parameters to minimize loss, for example, by using gradient descent. And that works by calculating the gradient or the slope of a loss function with respect to each parameter. Using the gradient of the loss function, optimization algorithms determine which direction to step the model in order to move down the gradient and therefore reduce loss. The model learns by updating the weight and bias terms until the loss function has been sufficiently minimized. So that's loss function. It's both a scorekeeper that measures how well your model is performing and a guide that directs the model's learning process. And thanks to Loss Function, my colleague can keep tweaking his YouTube AI model to minimize the loss and teach that model to make better predictions.